Good morning, everyone. Stephen Whiteside here. It is Friday, August 1st, 2014. And yes, I did previously say I wasn't going to do a video this morning, but it is the day after, and you don't see the Dow dropping 300 points every day. So let's do a quick video this morning. It's 7 a.m. on the East Coast, and Dow futures down about 100 points in the pre-market. So we're looking for some continuation to the down move on Friday. Now, there is some economic numbers coming out at 8:30 this morning that could change the direction of the futures, but so far it looks like we're going to see a continuation of what we saw yesterday. Now, the Dow dropped 300 points yesterday. Were we expecting that? Not yesterday. No, we weren't expecting it. We were expecting the market to move lower. We were already on a sell signal for the Dow and the S&P 500. So for those people who are long bearish ETFs or short the markets, congratulations. And you've got your price targets, and you'll take money off the table as you hit those targets. Now, one of the things that made us concerned about the stock market, of course, was that the risk-off trade was actually on. And so for the month of July, people had been leaving mid-cap and small-cap stocks, the fun stocks in the market, and moving money into bigger and bigger cap stocks. And so the NASDAQ 100 and the five stocks that make up the majority of the NASDAQ 100, that index continued to move higher. The Dow was moving higher. The S&P 500 was moving higher. But people were moving out of mid-cap stocks, like in the Russell 2000, or small micro-cap stocks, like in the Zacks Micro-Cap Index. And so that was a little bit of an alarm bell there that something wasn't right, that all the soldiers were not walking in the same direction. So the NASDAQ 100 is now on a sell signal as of Thursday's close. Now, north of the border, things are still holding up. We're still on a buy signal here. Close on Friday below 15,319 would change that. The major reason we have a divergence between the markets is, of course, the financial services sector, which looks like this in Canada and this in the U.S. And if you've been watching our Volume Leaders videos, you know that we've been watching Bank of America, which is, of course, usually in the top of the most active list in the U.S. And that stock has been treading water for quite a while now, and no upward momentum whatsoever. So U.S. bank stocks down yesterday, still above their July lows. But again, we really didn't gain very much during the month of July. So the lows aren't really that far away. Now, looking at a long-term chart, this is a monthly chart of the Dow. You really can't notice yesterday's down move at all. Still trading above the upper channel line. So obviously, if we continue down on Friday, there will be some new weekly sell signals. But taking a look at a long-term chart, you can't notice what happened. And the VIX was up 46% for the month of July, but really on a long-term chart, you can't really notice that either. What you can notice, though, is things are starting to turn blue. And so we might be starting to trend higher for the VIX. And I have a long VIX play that isn't making any money just yet. But then I wasn't expecting to make money on a one-day move in the market. And so if we can get the market trending, continuing to trend lower, the VIX will continue to trend higher. Now, one little stat that you probably are not aware of, and that's the fact that the Dow is now actually negative for the year. That is not true for the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ 100, but for the Dow, we actually slipped below where we opened on January 2nd. A quick look at the commodity ETFs this morning. We've got copper still treading water in the channel. No change there. We're already short gold coming into yesterday's trading activity. We are getting pretty close to the bottom of that open gap on the GLD. And so it'll be interesting to see how the market reacts to the bottom of that open gap, if we trade through or if we find a bounce there. We are trading below July lows in gold. We are trading below July lows in platinum. And again, there's an open gap that the market is dealing with right now. And for silver, silver's holding the July lows so far. And again, we've got an open gap there that could act as a price magnet, act as an area of support, or act as a big tell if we trade through that open gap. Looking at energy, we've got crude oil trading through the July lows, heading towards the May lows. That gasoline has already broken, and natural gas saw a bid on Thursday. And so if natural gas can close above 21.46 on Friday, that would give us a new buy signal for the UNG. Last up, a quick look at the 60-minute charts. Came into yesterday, we were already trading above the flypaper channel for the VIX. We're already on a buy signal for the VIX, and so an hourly close below 1483 on Friday would give us a new intraday sell signal for the VIX. That would be supportive for higher stock prices. If on this chart we're closed at 1931 and we need to be above 1954, that is quite a leap, and we're heading in the other direction. I think the last time I checked, the S&P 500 futures were down about 12 points. So 1954.85, 39.37.50 for the NASDAQ 100, and 99.93 for the XAU. I don't think you're going to see any buy signals on Friday on the intraday charts. Looking north of the border for the TSX, we're looking for an hourly close above 15,425. And for the financial services, we are on a sell signal, but certainly we only dropped 0.61%. The Dow, S&P, all those were down like 2% yesterday. So a very minor pullback for financial services, and an hourly close above 259.50 would give us a new intraday buy signal for the financial services sector north of the border. Okay, folks, that is all for this morning's presentation. I just put this up recently, never ask why. We could spend days, weeks, months looking at what happened yesterday. We could actually write a thesis on it. What you can't do is replicate the circumstances that showed up yesterday. The simplest explanation is we were overbought coming into yesterday and looking for a reason to sell off. Was the reason Argentina? Was the reason the Middle East? Was the reason what was going on in Ukraine and Russia? Was it corporate earnings? Was it economic news? Was it Congress? Who knows what it was or what set of circumstances? What I can tell you is everything that happened yesterday can never be replicated. What happened in Argentina, what's going on in the Middle East, what's going on in Russia and the Ukraine, the corporate profits that came out, the economic news that came out, what Congress is doing, that will never happen again on the same day. And so we could spend a lot of time analyzing what happened yesterday that led to a 300-point decline, and we could become experts in it, but we can't use that information ever again because those circumstances will never happen on the same day ever again. So we're overbought, looking for a reason to sell off. We've sold off. Have we been in a downtrend for any length of time in quite a while? No. Can we be in a downtrend for any length of time going forward? Sure. Days, weeks, months. Who knows how long it's going to be. So far, daily charts have been rolled over onto sell signals. That is not the case for weekly and monthly charts. So we're in a short-term decline for the time being. Okay, folks, have a great day. Have a great weekend. And we'll talk to you, unless the market breaks down dramatically on Friday. Next time you'll hear my voice is next Tuesday. Have a great weekend, and we'll talk to you again soon.